I want you to hear this in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28, 29, and 30. If you want to turn in your Bibles, you can. If you have your electronic device, that'd be great. We also will have everything right here on the PowerPoint behind me this morning. We're reading this from the Message, so you might have a different version or translation of Bible there, and that's okay. I don't often go to the Message, but looking at the verse comparatively, the verses comparatively, they not only say the same thing, but they say the same thing in a way to a generation today that needs to hear what Jesus has to say about freedom in Him. I love it. Matthew 11, 28, 29, and 30. Are you tired? Jesus asks. Worn out? Burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me. And you'll recover. Would you read that line with me just one time together? Get away with me. Here we go. Ready? Get away with me and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me, work with me, and watch how I do it. I love this. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. Oh, that's powerful. We'll talk about it. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me. And you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Can you give the Lord some praise for this word today? Pet store delivery truck was noticed in one particular city stopping at every single stop sign, stoplight, and the driver jumping out with a 2x4 and beating on the side of the truck. He would then jump back in the truck and he would drive to the next stop or light or sign and he would do the same thing. He'd get out, grab his 2x4 and beat on the side of that truck. Finally, down the stretchaway, somebody stopped him and said, "What in the world are you doing?" And his response was simple. He said, "I've only got a 2-ton truck and I'm carrying 4 tons of canaries. So at every stoplight, I get out and I beat the side of the truck because I've got to always keep 2 tons in the air all the time." I read that story this week. Yeah, you can laugh. It's okay. Maybe it's not funny. But I read it, and here was my thought. My thought, Danny, was how many of us in life go through life using that 2x4 mentality? Think about it. We have some really heavy things in our life. Am I talking to anybody? I'm going to put my hand up first so you don't feel alone. But am I talking to anybody today who's got some heavy things going on in your life? Come on, are there a few hands today? A few? All right, good, good. Then you're in the right place at the right time. And the rest of us will be along for the ride today as well, right? I have a lot of things heavy in my life, and you do. And some of us watching today via our live stream, or those who might watch this later this week, heavy things. Can I tell you, and I've done this, I've used the 2x4 mentality in my life. See, he was trying to keep the truck from crashing because, you know, 4 tons of canaries, if that's possible. I'm thinking, like, is that even possible in a 2-ton truck? He's beating us to keep the, and I'm thinking, we go through life the same way. We have some heavy things that we're using this 2x4 mentality, trying to keep some things in our lives, like hurts, habits, and hang-ups. And we're trying to keep them afloat just enough so we don't crash. But I'm here to tell you today, you don't have to use the 2x4 mentality. Jesus Christ came into this world not only to give us eternal life, meaning someday every one of us in this place, every one of us will close our eyes to this life, and we will open our eyes to another. Jesus came so that when we open our eyes to another life, that we open our eyes to a life of freedom and closeness to God. There's one of two places for us to end up in eternity, and Jesus came to give us eternal peace and rest. But he didn't only come for that. He came to give you some peace and rest today. There's heavy things that you and I deal with. And this is what we've been talking about. We've been talking about celebrating freedom. And we're using an acrostic. The acrostic we're using is simply the word recovery. And they can just bring this up really quickly as I move along through this. And we're on the third message of this series entitled Celebrate Freedom. But using the word recovery, the first step, and it really is the initial step, is to realize that you're not God. Your life is unmanageable. And you need God to help you manage the things that you see and feel are unmanageable in your life. And for everybody, it's probably something different. The second thing we talked about a couple of Sundays ago was that we have to earnestly believe that God exists. We have to really recognize that we matter and He wants to help us. Those are two initial steps. It doesn't matter what your hurt is. It doesn't matter if you're struggling from relationship breakups of the past, people coming into your life and then dumping you madly, just dumping you and leaving you. It doesn't matter if it's an addiction, alcohol, drug addiction of any kind, prescription drug or non-prescribed drugs. It doesn't matter if it's a hang-up, an emotion, an attitude, a feeling that is just depression or whatever it may be that just pulls you down and drags and tears at you. Can I tell you, these steps are all so important. Realize that you're not the boss. You're not in control. 2x4 mentality has got to go out the door. If you really want freedom and you really want to recover from these hurts, hang-ups, and habits, you're going to have to recognize that God is always large and in charge of your life. You've got to recognize that He exists. But this is what I thought this week. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if all you do is recognize He exists, if all you do is recognize that He's the boss, you still won't find freedom until you, our third topic today, somebody needs to get this down today, write it in your notes, side of your Bible, front of your Bible, tithing envelope in front of you, jotted into your phone and in your notes. Number three is, unless you consciously choose to commit all your life and will to Christ's care and control, there's no way. Lots of people believe that God exists. Lots of people. We said last week, shockingly, I was totally surprised. Out of a few thousand people that were polled a few years ago, 98% said, yeah, I believe God exists. Only 2%, less than 2% said, I don't believe there's a God. I was blown away by that Gallup poll. It makes you want to kind of do it here in Pekin, right? You want to take a clipboard and just begin asking people, do you believe there's a God? Or do you believe God exists? But it's not enough. It's not enough to believe He exists. It's not enough to believe He's this or He's that or He's... It's that step today we're talking about. And for many here this morning, listen, I can share with this passion because I am this. I am. I am that person just like you, who's had to draw a line in the sand and cross over and say, I'm tired of this 2x4 mentality. And I love the way the Message wrote our opening text, because the opening says, are you tired? Are you tired of religion? And that's really what a person has. If you go to church, you can be as involved as you want to be. You can be in church leadership. Pastor John would say amen. You can be a pastor and still be trying to go through life with a 2x4 mentality of not totally surrendering your life to Jesus and just trying to keep things afloat so your life doesn't crash. We're here to try and to help you find freedom, total freedom in Jesus. As Jesus said in this portion of Scripture, He asked the question, He said, how many want to recover their life. That is so powerful. Do you want to recover your life? Get away with me, he said. Can we pull this up again? I think I might have it there on the PowerPoint. Get away with me and recover your life. Wow, what a deal. Somebody say amen. Come on, I'm not convinced. Amen. What a deal. Get away with me and recover your life. Why would anybody turn this down? Why would anybody here this morning? See, in just a little bit, there's going to be what we call the altar call, and that's a call for people to respond. Now, whether you come forward or you stand in your seat, sit in your seat, there's going to be an opportunity for you to make a decision, to choose something today, to choose freedom from something you've been struggling with, or to walk out this door and take your 2x4 right along with you and continue beating yourself through life, hoping and praying that you don't crash. You're going to have that opportunity to choose. Why would anybody not want to consciously choose to commit their life to God, to surrender themselves completely over to Christ's care and control when He is so proven? God is so proven. I've been posting little YouTube videos, if anybody's been watching our Facebook page, little YouTube videos from individuals, men and women, who have walked through what's called a Celebrate Recovery, a Christian program for healing and deliverance in our lives. Hundreds of thousands of people have walked through this church program, and we're praying and hoping to launch one very soon here as we, with a group of leaders, continue to train and work. Yes, it's okay to... And we put testimonies. These are testimonies that we find from men and women from drug addiction and alcohol and emotional depression and mental health issues. And they're standing, and you need to listen to these videos. We don't just, you know, post them to keep our page busy. We post them so that these things can minister to you, of people who have found real people, real life, found a real God who proved that He is greater, that He is bigger, He is able. And so I've asked this question all week long, and I'm going to give you four words for you to write down today. And the question is this: what keeps you, what keeps me from taking this step of surrendering my life to God wholly and choosing to allow Him to have complete control of my life? And I would say this: I don't care how long you've been going to church. It doesn't matter to me what position you hold at this church. Really, today, every single one of us in this room have things that we're going through. Every single one of us at every stage of life, no matter how deep our relationship is with God, whether you're at this part of the bench, you know, let me go this way, you've just started out your relationship with Him, or your benchmark, you've been serving the Lord and going to church for quite a while, we all have things in our lives that we need to surrender to Him. Stop using the 2x4 mentality and choose today, choose Him. See, one more thing before we get into the four words. We don't realize that our life is being controlled by something, someone, every single day. True. Thank you, front row. Our lives, every day, you might be being controlled by people's opinions of you. You might be being controlled by the dysfunction that maybe you grew up in as a kid. You may be being controlled by relationships that went wrong, and these people are still hurting you and affecting you in life, and you're carrying this weight and baggage. Maybe you had some really, really terrible, awful experiences, and you're walking under the umbrella, the shadow of an umbrella, of a backdrop of gloom and doom and despondency and despair. Every one of us in this place has a place in our lives where there's room for freedom. And if there's somebody in here right now who there's no room in your life for freedom, then I would gladly fold up this Bible, switch chairs with you, and you should be the one preaching this message today. Because I stand here today as someone as well. Areas of my life, I've got to trade in my 2x4. And I've got to embrace the cross. And I've got to realize, Jesus, if I can give you control of even those little areas of my life that I have been trying to control myself, I know that whom the Son sets free. Whew. Boy, listen to y'all quote the Word of God this morning. We can quote it. Why don't we do it? Here's one reason why we don't do it. Pride. I didn't say this was going to be an easy message. I said it was going to be a good message. There's a difference. Pride. Do you know pride has led people down the road of ruin for a lot of years? The Bible says this, Proverbs chapter 8, I love it. Whenever I'm reading in Proverbs and I stumble on this verse, I look at it and I say, oh, that verse is there. I forgot about this one. This is great. Proverbs 8, 12, and 13, Holy Spirit, through the writer, speaks in really first person. I love it. I am wisdom. I have insight. I have knowledge and sound judgment. Verse 13, to honor the Lord is to hate evil. Wisdom says, I hate pride and arrogance and evil ways and false words. Why would wisdom hate false words and evil ways? Because they're two completely separate paths. The path of wisdom, which God chooses for us to walk, and the path of self-consciousness and selfishness, which we walk, which can lead us down a path of evil and false words. Look at this next verse. It'll get a little better. This is a little bit, you know, heavy riding right now, right? But look at this next verse in Proverbs chapter 10, verse 8. This one's rugged. The self-sufficient fool falls flat on his face. Come on. I'm going to put my hand up first. Has anybody been the epitome of this verse before? I'm just looking because the rest of y'all is coming to the altar at the end of this service. I've been that. You know, I say maybe you're not, maybe I'm not ready, Pastor Darren. I'm not ready. Pride. Is it possible that your pride is keeping you from that complete surrender of choosing and allowing Jesus to be in control of your life? Pastor Darren, I'm not ready. And the reason I'm not ready, I said this a couple of weeks ago. Do you remember me saying that some come by the light, but everybody comes by the heat? Huh? Do you know what I have found out? 30 years of serving Jesus, 51 years of age. Do you know the most valuable thing that I have recognized in my own life? I've recognized that in my experience with God, it's not until my pain outweighs my pride. Woo! Somebody out there is thinking, well, Pastor Darren, you should be in the altar this morning. Oh, I will be. I will be. Pride. I've just discovered until, and the Lord, you, why do bad things happen to good people? Man, she goes to church. She's the first one to lift her hands in worship. But yet, man, her life, we look at other people. Man, look at their life. I don't understand why all this bad stuff is happening to such a good, God-fearing woman or man. God allows stuff in my life. He allows pain. Oh, I don't like that part. I know, but he does. He allows pain in our life. Why? Because some come by the light, but all come by the heat. Pain is one of those things that will bring me to a place. I told somebody this morning, if he doesn't mind, I was talking to Jerry Eldridge. Jerry's had, you know, back issues over the years, and just with what I've walked through, I was telling Jerry, I said, Jerry, this was a very humbling thing. And he's like, yeah, it is. And have you ever, spiritually speaking, had your back go out of joint. And spiritually, it's like, oh, oh. And then what you don't want to do is you don't want to go over to the couch that's nearest to you and fall down in it, because you're going to have a real hard time getting out. Just letting you know. Have you been there spiritually? It literally puts you on your knees. If you've ever had any kind of back pain or back issues, it puts you on your knees. Here's a spiritual spinal cord truth. God allows my back at times, my spiritual back, to slip a disc. And he does, because sometimes, Alex, I need the pain to be greater than my pride. I need to be humble. He knows me better than you. He knows me better than my wife. And he knows in my life the things that I'm going to have to walk through. But here's the great thing. When I choose to surrender it to him, then nothing else can control me. All these things in life that control me that I don't have a choice and I did not choose, I choose him. And when I choose him, he walks with me through it. And the end result is always a better picture than the former. Always, every time. Because the heat, woo, I'm watching the clock and I got to move forward quickly. The heat does a whole lot more sometimes than the light. I'm thankful for the light, but that heat will mold our lives. Write down this second thing. The second thing is guilt. And I would even sacrifice my time this morning to spend, you know, the greater portion of what I have left with you today on this and do the next two very quickly, because this one's powerful, and I felt all week in my heart that somebody's going to hear this, and there's going to be a click in your spirit. You're going to say, that's me. Guilt will keep me from turning to Jesus. The psalmist said in Psalm 40:13, problems far too big for me to solve, piled higher than my head. Meanwhile, my sins, too many to count, have caught up with me, and I'm ashamed. I'm ashamed to look up. You know, maybe you told God, don't look around. Please keep looking right up here at me. God, if you get me out of this, God, if you get me out of this trouble, God, if you get me out of this mess, I'll surrender my life over to you, or I'll stop doing bad things. You know how it goes, right? He did, and you didn't. And guilt. Maybe you're someone today who's living under the guilt of dumb stuff that you did. Let's see another show of hands. How many has done dumb stuff? We've already settled this score before, haven't we? Yeah, Isaiah, yeah, he just, both hands. We've done dumb stuff. That's a proud mama back there. Yeah, that's a dumb. Maybe you've done some dumb stuff. You've hurt people. You've hurt people maybe physically. Hurt people emotionally, maybe bullied somebody, maybe spread a rumor on somebody that wasn't true and you knew it, but you're just trying to get back at them for maybe some pain they caused you. You've hurt, you've afflicted, and you're living under that guilt. Maybe you went to a party, maybe several parties over several years, doing some real disgusting, shameful things. And you're listening to this, or you're sitting here today, and you're thinking, I've said too much and I've done too much. There's no way God would ever help me. There's no way. Are you hearing me today? If you say amen, I'll get done quicker. Amen. Oh, wow, that's great. There's no way God will help me. I'm going to tell you a true story. True story, a pastor's teenage son hated, resented who he was. He hated what his dad did, and he despised God even more for making his dad a pastor. He journeyed down a road that began in his teenage life That was seriously painful. He rebelled hardcore. I mean hardcore. His dad, one Sunday, was standing center stage, as he often did at the end of service. There was a big, big wooden cross that was suspended from the ceiling, and it kind of tilted like this so that everybody could see. Big. Remember that wooden cross? Some of you remember we had a probably that size cross hung. And Sunday after Sunday, the teenage boy's dad would preach from under that cross. And then he would give an altar call. And then when he closed, he would stand right under that cross and he would pray and ask people to stand and bow their heads and close their eyes. And he would pray blessing over the congregation. One Sunday, while Dad was praying that prayer and heads were bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to guess that there were some heads not bowed and some eyes not closed, because there were a group of people that actually saw this 14, 15, 16-year-old boy during the time of his dad praying under that big wooden cross and talking to God, speaking blessing on the congregation. He was standing up on the very back seat in the middle, and he was flipping both middle fingers up at his dad and at the big wooden cross, because he resented who he was. He hated his dad was a pastor, and he resented God for making his dad a pastor. It's a true story. This boy went through a lot of pain. We don't even have probably time to justify the things that he went through. The darkness, the depravity that he brought upon his own life, the brokenness and the journey. But here's some good news. At the end of that journey, so broken, the heat applied to his life so harshly that there was a day in this young man's life that he turned to Jesus and he asked Jesus to forgive him of all of his sins and to come into his heart. Well, that's not the best part. You can clap, but hold on to this. You ready? Now here's a place to clap. You ready? Today, the church where his dad preached and prayed under the cross, that church now calls him pastor. Imagine that. And every Sunday, he stands under that cross where his dad did for so many years. And he preaches the love of Jesus Christ. And in what is now today a megachurch, he prays over that congregation from underneath that wooden cross. I'm here to tell you today, you may think you've done something so bad and you're under such guilt and condemnation that God doesn't want anything to do with you. I'm telling you, you're wrong. Satan has told you a lie. Somebody has told you a lie. But God's saying to you this morning, would you let go and let me? Would you choose me and allow me to lighten your load? Throw the 2x4 away and reach out to the old rugged cross, and I'll make a change in your life. Here's the next two things. Write them down because they are important. But that last one, guilt, was big. Someone in your seat right now can't wait until we open up these altars and ask for people to be prayed for. But hold right on for a moment. Fear. Fear is the third thing that will keep you from... I know this sounds just simple, but you know, chances are with this crowd that we have here today that there's many in this room right now dealing with pride issues, guilt issues, and fear issues. If you've been around the church for any amount of time, and I'm sharing this story because it's a great story and there's new people here who've never heard it. Hallelujah! So hang on to this one. There was a hiker hiking and he slipped over the edge of the cliff. He slipped and he caught a branch and he's hanging there dangling between life and death. He's looking at the rocks way below that if he lets go of this branch, he's going to plummet to his death. And he's screaming at the top of his lungs to whoever might hear him, another hiker maybe passing by. Is anybody up there? Is anybody up there? And then out of seemingly like the air from up over the top of that cliff, a voice says, I am the Lord. Let go of that branch. And I'll catch you. He's dangling, looking down, looking up, looking down, looking up, until he cries out and he says, hey, is there anybody else up there? fear. How many, honestly, you've heard that before? Oh, wonderful. There's some newbies here today. I've been telling that for about 30 years, haven't I, Karen? Some of you have been hanging on the branch, hanging on and hanging on. Today you're going to hear the voice of the Lord say, let go of the branch. There's somebody here. You're here on purpose, intentionally. Holy Spirit has allowed you to be here today. Listen to this today. And he's going to ask you the question at the end, before we open up the altars and a little more music starts. He's going to ask you, will you let go of the branch and let me catch you? Fear. But I don't want anybody controlling me. Man, stop kidding yourself. You're being controlled by something. But the Jesus way is to choose who you're going to be controlled by. Fear. Oh. The last one, doubt. Doubt will keep me from the best decision I've ever made. One of the Bible's most powerful, scenes in Scripture is in Mark chapter 9. And this father has a son who's possessed by a demon. Dark, extremely dark demon. And the father comes to Jesus, and we're going to jump right in the story. That's all you got to know. Now we're going to jump in the story. And this is what he says to Jesus. He says, Jesus, if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. And Jesus responds, if you can? Can't you kind of see this? I mean, I'm ad lib here. I'm dramatizing this a little, but if you can, say what? Everything is possible for the one who believes. And I like this. Now, this is the best part. Immediately, the boy's father exclaimed, I believe! See, even this morning, there will be those who will say, I believe! You're saying it right now. You're thinking, oh, the altar call will come, and I won't be going down there because I believe. The altar call is going to be for all those who don't believe. You know, I've been doing this a long time. You know, go, Pastor Darren, I'm right behind you. I'm in your corner, man. I'm fanning the flame today. But every word that you're speaking to me right now, I'm shoveling it over into the neighbor's backyard. It's can't be for me. It must be for the person sitting behind me. Don't look around and see who's there. Please don't do that. It must be for them. Well, here's the deal. How many times have you gone to church? You maybe heard the greatest sermon you ever heard in your life. So inspired. Man, you felt like, wow, if I ever believed that God could, if I ever believed it, man, this guy is in Jesus in the flesh. He says, well, if you can, if you can, you know who you're talking to. If you can, and then he says, Oh, and this is the Christian thing to say. See, here this morning, this is the Christian thing. Yes, Lord, I believe. But then look what he says. Reality kicked in. I don't know if he was, I don't know what the deal was, if he was walking away or if he was still there and had a change of mind. But then the next words out of his mouth, what does he say? The real truth came out, Tom. Lord, yeah. Help my unbelief. Who here today has some unbelief in your heart? Does it make you a bad person? No. Does it make you a non-Christian? Absolutely not. Please don't hear. If you're thinking I'm saying that, you don't know me. You need to take me out for a coffee and spend some time with me. You don't know me if you think that's what I'm saying today. It's real easy to give grace when others have shown you a lot of grace. It's easy to give grace when Jesus has shown you grace. Jesus said, walk in the rhythms of my grace. Walk in the rhythms of my grace. And maybe some of us here today are saying this. Pastor John, are we doing live music today? Come on up. Maybe some need to say, because there's some doubt, God help me to overcome my belief. Let me tell you one more thing. What next? How do I take this next step? You want to jot these down? You probably don't even have to because they're so easy. How do you take this next step? Well, the first thing is that you accept Jesus Christ, God's Son, as your personal Savior. You can pull up the scripture. I won't read it for time's sake. How do I do that? Simple prayer. Do you know what some of my early prayers were like? And I guess probably some of them today. Help! And it might have been like the guy hanging on the branch. Maybe not saying, is anybody else up there, but saying, God, are you up there? You know, we grew up thinking, you know, like there was this systematic prayer that we had to pray. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. I surrender. Come live in my heart. And those are great prayers. Please don't get me wrong. But I'm going to tell you what. Standing here this morning, recognizing you need God, recognizing that it's been maybe pride or doubt or fear or guilt that has been keeping you, holding you back, and just standing here today saying, God, help me to believe. Here I am. Intentionally. And then the second thing, bring this up, bring the next two up. The second thing is you need to accept God's word as your standard for living. Henry, 12 steps, AA, powerful, huh? Powerful. Well, listen, the book right here, here's your roadmap. Here's your manual. Not only does this have 12 steps, but this book right here is a manual over help you to overcome any situation, circumstance, hurt, hang up, or habit, the Word of God right here. Every situation in life, the answers are right here in this book. 66 chapters. Well, depending on how big your print is, and I'm learning that I'm needing bigger print, a little over 1,000 pages, your manual. You need to turn your life over to the Word of God. Well, I don't know what the Word of God says. That's why you go to church. It's why you get involved in e-groups. It's why, men, we have a men's e-group on Sunday morning where they learn more about the Word of God. You put yourself around people who are learning and growing in the Word of God. This right here. Don't stop the programs. Don't stop the counseling. The book, the manual, the roadmap. You've got to surrender. And those who don't, I'm telling you, those who don't, they never recover. You can't recover. It's like beating a truck with a 2x4, trying to keep 2,000 tons of canaries in the air. And the last thing, Pastor Darren, I can't do this. I've tried before. Or maybe I've never tried. It sounds so simple. It can't work. It's too simple. Accept the Lord and then follow the Word of God. It's too simple. Yeah, well, here it is. Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Him. Woo! All right, you guys about ready? Can you play something real soft, unrhythmic? Stand with me this morning, would you please?